Hashtag She Lied About Me Too and Truth and Reconciliation. Hey, it's Prince of Queens, and I was hanging out a few days ago with my mother to do some post-Christmas shopping because we're that type of family. We're also people who come from the far left, and my mother was a feminist for most of my life and still could be considered fairly blue pill about some of those issues. However, she's also been quite red-pilled around the gender-specific issues of men and boys and has even watched the movie The Red Pill on two separate occasions. She agrees very strongly that males are being treated horribly both socially and by tangible systemic factors, and she sees that there is a massive problem with man-hating feminists who have a lot of power in our institutions and government. She basically kinda gets it. However, she still seems to have what I feel is a naive trust that the good feminists, who are mostly nice people and want genuine fairness, she thinks that the good feminists might have a fair amount or any actual influence over feminist organizing, advocacy, lobby groups, and education. And that's where I think that she and I differ. I think, personally, that the feminists with power and influence in the greater organizations, which are government-funded to the tune of billions of dollars a year in the West, purposefully keep their followers ignorant of their true beliefs and practices, and they'd turn on their followers if their followers learned about their true nature and objected to what the powerful feminists were actually doing. And most of their followers probably would, because most of their followers are probably nice people who just have no idea how heinous the powerful feminists really are. But my mom doesn't really quite seem to see what I feel is plainly evident if you examine the evidence for a long enough period of time. Still, of course, she hasn't entirely examined the evidence outside of some videos I've shown her, some stories I've told her about, and having her watch The Red Pill. Basically, she's been told about the problem, but she hasn't really seen the problem. In order to truly believe it, you have to truly see it happen. You'll have to see instances of something unjust happening to an innocent man or woman, usually at the hands of career feminists, where you think to yourself, wow, this is too messed up for people to ignore. And yet somehow the media sides with the feminists and they basically get away with it. That all said, let's shift gears. My mother was talking to me about some radio show she was listening to about feminism being the word of the year, and apparently they started talking about the hashtag MeToo campaign and how maybe it was going to be some sort of turning point for women who have been abused or something. I was like, nope, this is not a turning point. It's nothing more than the changing of the guards. They came after George Takei, of all people, with allegations from something like 30 years ago. Obviously, this has to do with politics and throwing the celebrities under the bus who failed in keeping the Democrats in power. My mother admitted openly that she somewhat agreed because, again, she is fairly red-pilled about a lot of things and actually knows quite a decent amount about politics. But then she started talking about a specific person who called the show she was talking about, this show where they were talking about feminism being the word of the year, who said something about how there could be some sort of real change if there were to be truth and reconciliation. And what does that mean? I asked. Well, I guess it's some sort of actual system of people admitting to their wrongdoings, and maybe people from both sides would theoretically be doing it, and they kiss and make up in some sort of formal way, or something. I don't know. She sort of explained it to me a little bit. I guess the method was used in South Africa when apartheid ended. Basically, it sounded a bit to me like what SJWs call accountability, which ideally is when people are confronted with their actions and given the chance to apologize or whatever, but usually just ends up in massive vindictive public shaming. Still, my mother assured me that this wasn't what was meant by truth and reconciliation, and that it could be done in a legitimately positive manner, which was fair to both sides. So since we were eating lunch together, I was forced to believe her for the sake of conversation. And she asked me what my thoughts were about it. Eventually, I explained myself and explained that I was going to make a video about it, and thus, here is my conclusion about any potential truth and reconciliation that might come as a result of the hashtag MeToo campaign, in which presumably powerful men will be held accountable for being pervs and they will have a chance to apologize or whatever. I think that sure, it would be kind of cool if powerful men were being outed as some sort of predators that had taken advantage of their positions of power, and maybe eventually other men came forward and said that they too had done something wrong and that they would like to have better transparency and that they would live life better from that point onward as individuals. Would I be against that by itself? That would be a good thing, right? Why would I be against it? And I personally do my best to live by such principles myself. I am willing to give an apology for my imperfections, even to people who really don't deserve them as individuals. And you can see me doing such a thing in a recent live stream that I wouldn't wish watching on my worst enemy, but I did do it. However, I don't think that this truth and reconciliation thing is likely going to happen, even if it theoretically should, because we have to remember the elephant in the room, which is that the quote-unquote powerful men often don't really have all that much power, because public sympathies, media, academia, and even a major portion of the corporate world is all policed very heavily under the watchful eye of feminism, even still. You see, my assessment of the hashtag MeToo situation is not that women have organically decided to come forward and expose predators. Rather, it seems a lot more like an organized campaign for Feminism Incorporated to try to maintain the power they fought for tooth and nail with every dirty trick that they could come up with. One of the main dirty tricks that Feminism Inc. used to garner power was a massive slew of false allegations. From the patently false mattress girl story at Columbia, who was used as a national spokesperson to speak out about rape on college campuses by feminist politicians in the United States, or in Canada, we had career feminists like Stephanie Guthrie, who fabricated a story that she and a few others were being harassed by a man on Twitter and got him arrested and put on trial simply because he was winning an argument. She basically tried to set legal precedent that you weren't allowed to argue with feminists on Twitter in Canada. You see, powerful men do abuse their power sexually, not uncommonly. But powerful feminists, and sometimes even average women, very often lie about men, and even other women, for whatever reason. They lie for several reasons. They lie for power, to ruin the reputation of somebody who is exposing their nefarious actions, and in the case of Mattress Girl, she seemed to just lie out of revenge because her heart was broken. And let's be honest, out of all of the feminist serial liars that we do know about, how many more of them are out there? Where's the hashtag She Lied About Me Too campaign? Seriously. Is that one gonna come anytime soon? I can think of a few women who have blatantly lied about me offhand, usually after they were the ones at fault in a conflict and I had the audacity to gasp, stick up for myself and tell people what happened. And then the woman just went on to use the fact that I am a male against me by way of blatantly lying and faking distress and assuming people would side with the girl. And sadly, a few people did each time. So here's what I'm thinking. If people asked men for some truth and reconciliation, they might get some guys who have done something wrong to be willing to preemptively try to conduct damage control in regards to the reputation that they might lose when one of their victims potentially comes forward. There might be a few powerful men that fear being outed as predators because they did do something wrong, who come forward and admit to what they did. Good for them. However, if that started happening, at this point in time, I have a slight suspicion that eventually, especially if some of the usual suspect feminists came out of the woodwork to help speak about these men, eventually more and more men would come forward to talk about being lied about by women. Men would say, well, if we're gonna talk about truth and reconciliation, can we talk about all of the false allegations that have ruined lives? If that were to happen, and I certainly hope that it would, then perhaps the whole truth and reconciliation might end up being abandoned by the very people who started it. You see, rape and sexually predatory behavior is a problem. It's always been a problem, and it probably always will be a problem, at least in our lifetimes. However, it's also always been a problem that people have attended to. Rapists and sexual predators are some of the most reviled criminals on the planet, which is why only the most powerful tend to get away with it at all. However, false allegations, at least in the current year, are both a seemingly largely ignored problem, but also something that seems like it came up more and more commonly recently, over the past couple of years. And there's a good reason for that. The powerful feminist establishment deliberately keeps it that way and tries to convince everybody that women never lie. And so, the elephant in the room, if feminists were to ask for truth and reconciliation, would be that they would theoretically have to own up to their own crap, at least as my mother explained it to me. And that would likely never happen because feminism's own crap is the backbone of the power and cultural relevance that they have. Feminism has become rich, powerful, and influential, not by producing a bunch of movies in the way that Harvey Weinstein did, but because feminists created a false narrative of males as oppressive, rapey monsters who can't help but rape and assault women all the time, all day, every day, including their wives, even on accident, apparently. That's sort of what feminist theory actually says. And so, while powerful men have a bit to lose by some of them admitting to occasionally being predatory, feminism has everything to lose by admitting to their own lies, because that is basically what their entire castle is built upon. I mean, they even started saying that gay men are constantly groping women. Like, seriously. Thus, maybe it would be cool if legitimate truth and reconciliation were to happen, but if that requires both sides to own up to their own crap, I imagine the biggest resistance would come from Team Feminism, the people who asked for this process to begin with. That's all I have to say for this video. Stay tuned.